فؤادك الأيام فتى.
القبوريون وغيرهم من الذين يعتقدون في فسقة الناس وجهالهم من الأحياء يقولون: نحن لا نعبد هؤلاء ولا نعبد إلا الله وحده، ولا نصلي لهم ولا نصوم ولا نحج
ولا نحج
ولا نحج.
These grave worshippers, فإن قلت, if you say to me, القبوريون, if you say to me that these grave worshippers and other than them, من الذين يعتقدون في فسقة الناس وجهالهم من الأحياء, who believe something in these ignorant transgressors, فساق, people don't pray, who drink alcohol, some of them, they think they're the awliya of Allah. Okay? في فسقة الناس وجهالهم من الأحياء يقولون, they will say to you, نحن we لا نعبد هؤلاء, we don't worship besides Allah. We don't worship these things that you can see, we don't worship them. ولا نعبد إلا الله وحده, and we don't worship except Allah. ولا نصلي لهم, we don't pray towards these people. ولا نصوم, we don't fast for them. ولا نحج, we don't do Hajj for these people. قلت, I will say to you,
هذا جهل بمعنى العبادة.
The reason why you're thinking that you're not worshipping them is ignorance of the word ibadah. So this is a problem. A lot of people don't even know what ibadah is. You know what they think ibadah is? Those three that they mentioned: fasting, praying, Hajj. They only think those are a handful of things. They think that's what ibadah is. Ibadah is a comprehensive word. You need to understand what ibadah is. Once you understand ibadah very well, its definition, what it means, then you can know, oh, I've diverted it. Something that is a ibadah, I gave it to other than Allah. Then you'll realize. Now he's going to explain it to you. Na'am. Rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'a.
فإنها ليست منحصرة فيما ذكرت.
You see, it's not exclusive to that which you mentioned. Some people only think that the ibadah is exclusive to salah, sawm, hajj. That's what they think. The Sheikh said, no. Your ignorance of understanding the word. And I tell you this, brothers. One of the things that people go misguided is why? It is the fact that they don't understand the terminologies. This is a big problem. And that's what the enemies of Islam try to do. I advise you all, if you can read the book Mahmoud Shakir, Ahmed Shakir's brother, the great Muhaddith, his brother. He has a book called Hadhihi Thaqafatuna. This is our heritage. This is our Islamic heritage. He wrote a book like that. And he talks about how the enemies of Islam, the kind of battles that they're trying to put towards the Muslims. Guess which battle they spend the most time on? Is through terminologies. They will go into your books and they will play with the usage of a word, water it down, so you don't understand what it means. Ibadah will be changed. Ibadah, and why? How? One of the things that made people misunderstand the word ibadah is when they translated it into the word worship. Because worship means something different to ibadah. Worship only means praying. That's only. Christians, or none of them, never believed that a man having intimate relationship with his wife is called a worship. What? Never. Ibadah for us can be all of that. It's comprehensive. Huh? It goes into how many things? So when you translate words, they have to be what? Like, for example, translating the word tawheed with monotheism. It's a mushkila. Because that's not the real meaning of it. That is not the real meaning of the word tawheed. Doesn't mean oneness of Allah is the best word. The oneness of Allah. Monotheism is not right. Monotheism means that you worship Allah alone. Monotheism means you worship Allah. It doesn't mean you only worship Him. You can worship besides Allah, tabarak wa ta'ala, something else. But it means you worship Allah, tabarak wa ta'ala. That's the meaning that they take from it. Christians, Jews, all of them believe that they are monotheistic religions. Do we consider them that? To us, they're mushrikeen. They are what? Mushrik. So when you use that word, he'll say, I fall under that word as well. Well, لذلك, some words, because the Arabic language is so powerful, it can't be translated into the English language. We should just take it from the Arabic and put it there like that. And say, when they ask us, what does it mean? Explain it to them, if we can't find the right word for it. So these words, tawheed, should be left with tawheed. if we can't find a good English word for it. So the word ibadah needs to be understood properly. The word ibadah, it's ignorance of that word. And that's why so many times you see people who go off track in terms of the understanding of the Sharia. He doesn't understand what this word means. Like the Asha'ira, the word istiwa, they had to tamper with that word for the meaning to change. So they said the word istiwa means what? Istawla. It means to overtake, to have, to own, to regain. You see, when the word doesn't mean that. The great grammarians of the Arabic language, like Ibn Arabi, the great Maliki scholar, not Ibn al-Arabi, but Ibn Arabi, the great Maliki scholar, who owns the book Al-Qabas, when he was speaking about the word istawa, he said the Arabs don't know istawa to be istawla. The Arabs don't know that. Sometimes you find a person say to you, Akhi, music is halal. What's your evidence? Hey, look at Imam Malik saying it's makruh. Ahmed saying it's makruh. Hey, what does makruh mean? What does the word makruh mean? To the Salaf, makruh meant haram. The meaning makruh, to be disliked, is a later used word. Even Allah in the Quran, He uses the word makruh as what? Haram. After Allah talked about zina, after Allah tabarak wa ta'ala talked about killing your child, after Allah tabarak wa ta'ala talked about big major sins, look what He said. وَكَانَ سَيِّئُ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ مَكْرُوهًا. Allah referred to zina as makruh. Allah referred to what? In Surah Al-Hujurat, what did Allah say? وَكَرَّهَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْكُفْرَ وَالْفُسُوقَ وَالْعُصِيَانَ كُفْرَ وَكَرَّهَ. Does that make sense? So what it means here, you have to understand the meaning of it before you start going out there and thinking something else. Huh? Like for example, I saw a man who said, أخي, you have to distinguish between Ahlul Kitab and Mushrikun. They're not the same. What's your evidence for that? Ha. What's your evidence for that? And then he goes into the ayah. Ha. Inna ladina وما أمروا إلا ليعبدوا الله مخلصين له الدين حنفاء ويقيموا الصلاة ويؤتوا الزكاة وذلك دين القيمة إن الذين كفروا من أهل الكتاب إن الذين كفروا. So he said you have to distinguish between the kuffar and أهل الكتاب. They do different things. أهل الكتاب are believers. Kuffar are something else. Ha. Why? Because Allah said إن الذين كفروا من أهل الكتاب. So from the أهل الكتاب, there are kuffar and some are not kuffar. But jahl comes from is that the word what? The min here is not meant by tab'idiyya. It's not some. This min is called bayanu jinsin. And it's like the ayah in Surah Isra where Allah says, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ. We send down the Quran as a cure. Can you say min al Quran that some of the Quran is a cure? In bayanul jins. So all of these, what I'm trying to say to you is that if you don't understand the word, based on that khubth and filth, and corrupt understanding comes from it. Does that make sense? ولذلك the Sahabas, if you look at them, like when they came to the Prophet, the ayah الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. When this ayah came down, they said, Ya Rasulullah, أَيُّنَا لَمْ يَظْلِمْ نَفْسَهُ. Ya Rasulullah, who is it from amongst us who has never transgressed on himself? Who is it, the one that has never done wrong, who's never transgressed? أَيُّنَا, which one of us? لَمْ يَظْلِمْ نَفْسَهُ. This ayah is saying, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, those who have come with iman, and then who have not clothed their selves with what? Oppression. أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنِ. Those are going to have safety on this earth. وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. They're the guided ones. Allah promised us safety, meaning Allah is going to give us aman on our lands, crops, safety, everything, when we come with what? When we stay away from dhulm. And Allah is going to give us guidance. So the Sahaba said, O Messenger of Allah, who is it from amongst us who doesn't oppress? Everyone oppresses. Where did they understand that it means that every oppression? All oppression. Where did they understand that from? The Arabic language. When they look at the ayah, what does it say? بِظُلْمٍ نَكِرَاتٌ. It's an indefinite. فِي سِيَاقِ what? الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ نَفِي. So it's an indefinite. In the context of what? We studied this in قَوَاعِدِ الْفِقْهِيَةِ the other day. An indefinite in the context of a negation shows what? Generalization. So it should mean every form of oppression. That's how they understood it. But then when the Prophet looked at them and he said to them, أَلَمْ تَسْمَعُوا. Have you guys not heard? قول الرجل الصالح, the speech of the righteous man. Who is it? Luqman. When he said to his people, what did he say? He said to his people, إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. Verily, shirk is what? It's So the dhulm here is meant by shirk only. So the Sahabas, they understood that word bi dhulmin in its general meaning. The Prophet came and he done takhsis of it. He narrowed it down for them. Alayhi salatu wasalam. So what does it mean, brothers? You have to go back to making sure you understand what the words in the Sharia mean. These have haqa'iq shar'iyyah. Inshallah ta'ala, when we come to our inshallah bidhni Allah al-Kareem, when we study our other books in Usul al-Fiqh, we will study that every kalam, it's divided into haqa'iq, literal meanings. And there's haqa'iq lughawiyyah, haqa'iq shar'iyyah, haqa'iq urfiyyah. Ha! And based on those three different haqa'iq, or those three different types of definitions, the word's meaning is taken out from it. So what does ibadah mean? The reason why these grave worshippers believe, the reason why they believe that ibadah is only mahsurun, it is only exclusive to salah, siyam, and hajj is why? Because they don't even understand ibadah. So it's upon the du'at to start from the foundation, to speak to these people about what is ibadah. What do you understand as ibadah? Wallahi, billahi, tallahi, three names of Allah, I swear by. People whose beards are this big, who are du'at, who are out there teaching, wouldn't even understand, don't even know what ibadah is. Don't know what ibadah, akhi, give me a definition of ibadah. 10 years he's been doing da'wah. He was the front line in da'wah. Out there on the streets, hours of heat. If you ask him, akhi, what is ibadah? Give me a ta'rifun jami'un mani', a comprehensive definition of what ibadah means. وَقَلِيلٌ مِّنْ عِبَادِيَ الشَّكُورِ. Little from the servants of Allah, thank Him. A lot of them will tell you. And that's why a lot of the times when you look at the general mass, you think to yourself, I feel sorry for you guys. Because there is currently no one calling you to it. And we don't know anyone else who's coming up to do that. So it's important that the salaf, the ulama, they used to take time out to address this matter. So inshallah ta'ala, what does ibadah mean and what's the ta'rif of it?
بل رأسها وأساسها الاعتقاد.
Rather, رأسها, the head of عبادة. أساسها, its foundation. اعتقاده, and its belief.
وقد حصل في قلوبهم ذلك.
And that matter has actually, it's in their hearts. It's present in their hearts.
بل يسمونه معتقدا.
And rather they refer to it as what? Belief.
ويصنعون له ما سمعته مما تفرع عن الاعتقاد من دعائهم وندائهم والتوسل بهم والاستغاثة والاستعانة والحلف والنذر وغير ذلك.
So what they do, ويصنعون, they make له for them, these people they worship, they start making for them what? ما سمعته, that which you hear. مما تفرع عن الاعتقاد منهم, based on the belief that they have. دعاء, نداء, calling unto them. التوسل, استغاثة, استعانة, الحلف, النذر. All of those which are form of عبادات, they go and do it for what? Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah gave a comprehensive definition of what ibadah means. Comprehensive. In his book Al-Ubudiyyah, page 6, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said, Al-ibadatu, ibadah is, hiya ismun jami'un, it's a general term. لِكُلِّ مَا يُحِبُّهُ اللَّهُ وَيَرْضَاهُ, in everything which Allah loves. من الأقوال, in terms of speech. والأعمال, in terms of actions. الباطنة والظاهرة, that which is apparent and that which is within. Ibadah can be internally and it can be external. And it's also actions. It's also speech. Those are all ibadah. Allah loves it and He's pleased with it. You have to look for that. And then the Shaykh gives examples. فَالصَّلَاةُ وَالزَّكَاةُ وَالصِّيَامُ وَالْحَجُّ وَالصِّدْقُ الْحَدِيثِ وَأَدَاءُ الْأَمَانَةِ وَبِرُّ الْوَالِدَيْنِ وَصِلَةُ الْأَرْحَامِ وَالْوَفَاءُ بِالْعُهُودِ وَالْأَمْرُ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَالنَّهْيُ عَنِ الْمُنكَرِ وَالْجِهَادُ لِلْكُفَّارِ وَالْمُنَافِقِينَ وَالْإِحْسَانُ إِلَى الْجَارِ وَالْيَتِيمِ وَالْمِسْكِينِ وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ وَالْمَمْلُوكِ مِنَ الْآدَمِيِّينَ وَالْبَهَائِمِ وَالدُّعَاءِ وَالذِّكْرِ وَالْقِرَاءَةِ وَأَمْثَالِ ذَلِكَ مِنَ الْعِبَادَةِ. All of them are from ibadat. وكذلك حب الله ورسوله وخشية الله والإنابة إليه وإخلاص الدين له والصبر لحكمه والشكر لنعمه والرضا بقضائه والتوكل عليه والرجاء لرحمته والخوف من عذابه وأمثال ذلك هي من العبادة. All of those they fall under the terminology or the definition that the Sheikh gave. وذلك أن ذلك أن العبادة هي الغاية المحبوبة له والمرضية له التي خلق الله الخلق لها، كما قال تعالى: وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون يعبدون وبها أرسل جميع الرسل. انتهى كلامه الشيخ رحمه الله. Finally, after he mentions all of those things, that they are all types of عبادات, he says وذلك أن it is أن العبادة, that the ibadah, it is the objective, it is the goal. Allah created you from clay, placed blood circulation, all of this, eyes, ears, mouth, lungs, heart, everything, made your heart beat, and allowed you to live in this world for only one reason. So wrong that the whole purpose you were brought into this world. Allah didn't bring you so you can eat. Allah didn't bring you into this world so you can get married. Allah didn't bring you into this world so you can have children. Allah, all of those are side points. The objective of why you were brought to this world is al-ibadah. That is the primary reason of your existence. How is it that you're going to turn away from that real reason of the objective you were brought from? What? In which Allah wants you to come with. Your food, your marriage, your children are all a means to help you do your ibadah. That's how it should work. You have children, so you can do ibadah. So you can follow Allah's command in raising them. So you can teach them to become those who, next generation, who carry on Allah's worship. You see? When you eat, you're eating so you can pray the next salah. So you can fast. So you can make more dua. So you can slaughter for His sake. For you to do all the forms of ibadah there are. The eating is for that reason. But what have we done? Our ibadah is a means to what? To get money, to live, to get life. Our objective is what? Our objective is what? Our objective is our dunya. The person is looking for a fatwa if he can combine all the prayer. Well, that's, your money wasn't the real reason why you brought into this world. It's what, this is what the problem happens when the person does not know what, how to prioritize. Or he doesn't know which one is asal and which is a fara. He wants to combine the prayer for work. Which one was the asal? The asal was the ibadah. For him to worship Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and he's looking for this fatwa. For what? Because to him, the work, the job, the earning is everything to him. The ibadah, on the other hand, is a side branch, side point. Na'am. So the Shaykh says, وَذَلِكَ أَنَّ الْعِبَادَةِ هِيَ الْغَايَةِ الْمَحْبُوبَةِ لَهُ. It is the objective which Allah loves for you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. الْمَرْضِيَّةُ لَهُ, which He is pleased with. الَّتِي خَلَقَ الْخَلْقَ لَهَا. Allah created the creation for that. كَمَا قَالَ تَعَالَى, as Allah said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ وَبِهَا أَرْسَلَ جَمِيعَ الرَّسُولِ. If you think about it, Allah says something after وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ. Allah says in Surah Dhariyat, that same page, that same last part of Surah Dhariyat, what did Allah say after that? وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ رِزْقٍ وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ يُطْعِمُونَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ. Allah after told them ibadah, Allah told them, I don't want any provision from you. It's not like I want money from you, or I need you to help me. لا. Remember, لكن, I'm the one who's going to provide for you. كأن الله تبارك وتعالى is saying to you, through ibadah you will live. I will give you provision and how to gain something. You see? So this ayah, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ. So not only you, even the jinn, they were brought into this world for what reason? To worship Allah تبارك وتعالى. Look at how powerful. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ, and then إِلَّا. أدوات الحصر, always underline that. نَفْيٌ, استثناء, negation. And there's an exception in there. It has that powerful meaning. It's like لا إله إلا الله. Negation, and there's an exception there. It's to show you that powerful meaning, which is I didn't create you for no other reason whatsoever. That's the meaning it has now. Except what? To worship me, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah negated everything else. And He only affirmed what? That istithna is called what? Istithna muttasil. It's a exception, and that's the most powerful exception. Which is the exception which is connected to the sentence. It is not mufarraq, it's not distance from it. Na'am. It's the one in Surah Al-Asr. Wal-Asr, inna al-insana lafi khusr. Illa alladhina amanu. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala negated it from everybody else except these people. Na'am.
وَقَدْ ذَكَرَ الْعُلَمَاءُ أن من تزيى بزي الكفار صار كافرا.
The Shaykh رحمه الله تعالى رحمه الله, he talks about a matter which is very serious. He said that the ulama have mentioned أن من تزيى بزي الكفار صار كافرا. Anybody who dresses himself the clothing of the disbelievers, he is kafir like them. This speech of Imam al-San'ani rahimahullah ta'ala, it is unrestricted a bit. It's what? It's a bit unrestricted, so la budda an nuqayyidahu. We have to restrict it a bit, and we know what he means by it, rahimahullah ta'ala. So, فَلَيْسَ كُلُّ مَنْ تَزَيَّى بِزِيِّ الْكُفَّارِ صَارَ كَافِرًا وَمَا يَصِيرُ كَافِرًا. Not everybody who dresses himself like the way that the disbelievers dress themselves, does he become a kafir because of it? لا. That is not the case. But the one that is, إِذَا تَزَيَّى بِزِيِّهِمُ الَّذِي هُوَ فِي خَصِّصِهِمْ. If he tries to dress himself in a clothing which they are known for, it's uniquely theirs. It's clothing which are uniquely theirs. It's their clothes, their popes, their priests, they wear it. It's their clothes. With knowledge and intentionally, that one falls under this. Amma, as for these Muslims today who dress with these kind of caps and they wear these clothes and these gangster clothes and whatnot, huh? Then these one are la shakka wa la raib, they fall under the wa'id, the severe warning of the hadith of the Messenger, man tashabbaha biqawmin fahuwa minhum. And the matter is very serious. Wallahi al-azim, ulama have taken time out to write books on this. Ibn Hajar rahimahullah ta'ala, he talked about in his book the fasting on Saturday. Even though that book is mafqood, we don't have it today, but he speaks about it. Imam al-Dhahabi rahimahullah ta'ala, libas was kuffar, the clothing of the kuffar. Imam al-Dhahabi has a risala, a little book on it. He speaks about it. Ibn Taymiyyah, the best book ever written on this issue. Iqtida' salat al-mustaqim li mukhalafati ashab al-jahim. Ibn Taymiyyah, look what he does. He says that the straight path, to gain the straight path, he named his book what? To go on the straight path is to go against the path of the disbelievers. How is it that you read in Surah al-Fatiha, oh Allah, divert me from the path of the Christians and the Jews, and then as soon as you leave the salah, you're already imitating them again. 5 times a day, everybody reads that. 5 times a day. Each rak'ah. Ihdina الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Ibn Taymiyyah starts with that straight away. That the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said to his companions alayhi salatu wa sallam, he said, "Man tashabbaha biqawmin." Anyone who imitates a people is what? Fahuwa minhum. He's from those people he imitated. ولذلك the Salaf, they used to say, the imitating of the kuffar from the outer leads to the imitation of them in the heart. It is impossible that a people will imitate a people in which he differs from them within. It's impossible. And Ibn Taymiyyah brought practical examples in his great book, noble book, Iqtida' Salat al-Mustaqim. He said, if two army members, two men from the military, if they both came to a place where they knew nobody and they didn't know each other, but they saw each other's clothing, automatically they will sit and talk to each other. They become friends because they find a common ground which they have with one another. Clothing brings people together. If you're in a place where everyone else, and you see a Muslim brother with a lihya and everything, automatically you find yourself sitting with him and finding time with him. All of the other people don't have that with you. They're not Muslims. He's the only Muslim. You go and you sit with him. Na'am. The Prophet told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, "Al-mar'u 'ala dini khalilihi falyanzur hadakum man yukhalilu." The person is of the religion of his friend. Look who you take your friend, your religion, who you take as a friend. Also, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam said, "Al-mar'u ma'a man ahabba yawm al-qiyamah." The person is with who he loves the day of judgment. You're with the people you love. You want to walk like the Sahabas? You want to talk like the Sahabas? You want to act like the Sahabas? So tub'atu ma'hum. You'll be resurrected with them. Anas ibn Malik, he said, when the Prophet said that statement, that the person is resurrected with the people he loves, Anas ibn Malik said, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, there never came a day more happier to me than that day. Because he said, I knew I loved Abu Bakr. I knew I loved Umar. I knew I loved the Messenger. And I knew, inshallah, by my loving of them, that I'll be resurrected with them. So brothers, you have to understand, this issue of imitating the kuffar and wearing their clothing and dressing like them, it is a very serious issue. It's a very serious issue that the Muslims take very lightly, and it's a matter that falls under al-wala wal-bara. La shakka, it falls under the issue of wala wal-bara. Imitating the kuffar, walking like the kuffar, acting like the kuffar, dressing like the kuffar. Our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave us extensive and many different issues here and there. All of them were based on what? Lack of imitation of the kuffar. Just a couple of days ago, we passed the fasting of the day of Ashura. the messenger fasted the day of Ashura, and he was told that the Jews also do the same. Look what the Prophet said. He said, "Laysuhum ahaqqu bi Musa minna." They, كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, they are not more befitted for Musa, or Musa is not more closer to them, and they are not more related to Musa than over us. The day of Ashura, no. Like Musa is closer to us. So what did the Prophet do? Because they have they fast and they do what they do, the Prophet ﷺ said, we will oppose them in what? We'll fast the day before it or after it. So even if we have to do something they have to do, we will try to change the form of how we do it. We will change what? The way we do it. ولذلك, the Jews in Medina, what did they say? Wallahi, هذا الرجل ما يريد إلا أن يخالفنا. Muhammad does not want anything except to go against us. Everything he does, he finds out if we do it, and he goes against us on it. That's all he wants. Na'am. Even the Jews realize what? They realize that the maqsad of the Sharia, the objectives of the Sharia, ikhwani, is what? Al-bara'atu min ash-shirki wa ahla. To free yourself from shirk and his people. So trying to dress like them brings in your heart al-mahabba, al-wud, love, admiration towards them. Especially those who wear their football t-shirts and dressed with those clothes. Wallahi, ama bihi ammat bihi al-balwa. It is problems that have gone all over the world. See a person who lives in Somalia, who doesn't speak English, he tells you, a football player, he's got his t-shirt on, he's got the number, everything. How do you know this guy? You see, it's a problem. So the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala's statement here is unrestricted, but with its context and everything in there, لا شك ولا ريب, it's very serious. It's a dangerous issue, and you can realize how he's talking about it here. Na'am. So anything, if a matter is mushtabah, it's doubtful, stay away from it. Why would you want? Alhamdulillah, there's clothing you can wear which are out there, you can dress with. You love the Prophet. Do you really love him? Why are you not imitating him? Why don't you dress like him? Isn't it better for you to dress like him, alayhi salatu wasalam? La shak, is better. Na'am.
وَمَنْ تَكَلَّمُوا بِكَلِمَةِ الْكُفْرِ صَارَ كَافِرًا.
And anyone who speaks a speech of kufr, he's a kafir. Of course, when is it like in? إِذَا وُجِدَتِ الشُّرُوطِ وَانْتَفَتِ الْمَوَانِعِ. If the conditions are present and the obstacles are missing. نعم.
فَكَيْفَ بِمَنْ بَلَغَ هَذِهِ الرُّتْبَةَ اِعْتِقَادًا وَقَوْلًا وَفِعْلًا.
Then how is it the matter going to be? If the just by mere utterance, the person becomes a kafir. Just by imitating the kuffar from their outer with something they're unique from, it falls under that. Then what do you think? What do you think? A person who believes in this with speech and action, he believes in it, he's pushing it. Then what do you think?